Mesdames et messieurs, ladies and gentlemen, we're about to start our third plenary entitled Smart Global Investments. So let me begin by introducing our moderator for today's plenary, the Secretary General of the International Association of Universities, Eva Igron-Polak, right here. Next to her, we have Barbara Schneeman from the United States Agency for International Development, the Higher Education Coordinator. We're lucky to have her on two of our plenaries today. Then in the middle, we have Jean Lebel, the President of the International Development Research Center, one of our co-sponsors for this conference, followed by Shamsh Kasim Laka, the Executive Chairman for the Board Executive Committee at the University of Central Asia. And on the end, we have Jeffrey White, the Advisor for Education Global Practice at the World Bank.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, everyone. And first, let me say thank you for still being with us and participating so actively. We are almost at the end of a very exciting conference, and I would really like to congratulate the organizers on getting a couple of things right. I did hear the CEO of Ames suggest that a better representation from the Global South would be beneficial next time, but I do think that this conference has the unique feature of bringing together people from across the sectors, private sector, public sector, higher education institutions, but also, and that's even more unique, I think, a very good mix of generations. There are a lot of young people in this room. We haven't heard much from them, and I regret that a little bit, but I think their presence and their questions have been really stimulating, and that getting that right is very important. So, congratulations. It has been a really rich event, and this panel has a bit of a daunting task before it. We've been asked to do three things at the same time. The first is to, for each of the panelists to give you a sense of what they heard, what they're going to take away from this conference. Second, we've been asked a couple of quite important questions. The first one is what barriers we need to overcome in order to ensure that higher education is considered and is an active and an effective partner in international development and in the policy for development. And I think both in the North and in the South, that needs to be considered. And the third element of what we're to address is how to maintain this dialogue into the future. What mechanisms should we employ if they exist, or which ones should we invent in order for this dialogue and this platform to be continued? Before I turn to the panel, let me also share a little bit of what I heard. And I will do it in key words. I think starting from last night, I had identified six I words that struck me as being what we talked about a great deal. The first one was inclusiveness. Our Governor General started with that and repeated it. Second, innovation, investment, and I would say intelligent investment, even though it's called smart. For my sake, it's intelligent investment. Interconnectedness and integrity, which is another word for ethics. And those were words that went throughout the day and a half of our conversation. We also agreed on complexity, on the challenges that we all face, on the need for cooperation with all partners and stakeholders, on creativity, and on continuity, the timeline. So those were the C's. And now, I would like to hear from our panelists who've already been introduced, but I will just introduce them once more, what they have learned and will take away. First, Barbara Sheenan, who's speaking to us for the second time from USAID. We'll then go to Monsieur Jean Lebel, le président du CRDI. Professor Shams will speak next. He has an illustrious background as a former minister of education, former minister of science and technology in Pakistan, and a founder of the Aga Khan University. And now, as you have heard him before, he is the chair of the executive board of the Central Asian University. And finally, our colleague from the World Bank, who is the advisor to a new structure in the World Bank, which is called Education Global Practice. And they will go in that order, starting first with what they have learned. Barbara.
Thank you. If I did have slides for this presentation, I would start with a word cloud. I appreciate the I's and the C's. That's great. The word clouds that I would love to see are around the word local, because we've heard local come up in many ways, shapes, and forms relating to community. Access, that's the second word. And with access, we've not only heard it around individuals, we've heard it around resources, libraries, technical equipment, the kinds of things that enable work to happen. And then the third word cloud that I would love to see is relevance. And relevance, I'm going to dwell a little bit more on relevance because I think it ties back to both the local and the access part of it. Some of the concepts that I heard that were associated with relevance is that need for practical needs within the community. What are the health, economy, education, environment, but to really be driven by what is in the local context, and then how does our development serve that local context so what we do is relevant. There's also been a lot of discussion around evidence-based or evidence-informed decision-making in development work. And again, I tie that back to relevance because it's the evidence that we're looking for has to be relevant in that local context for it to be meaningful and for it to be useful. I think another dimension of relevance that has cut across many of the discussions is the challenge of evaluation. We all seem to agree that when we're talking about investment in higher education, that is a long-term development investment. And yet many of us work in agencies and situations where we're asked annually what we have done, and we're asked to justify our budget on an annual basis. I feel fortunate when we get to justify our budget on a five-year basis. At least it's more than 1 year. And so we get trapped in metrics that may be less meaningful in terms of what we're looking for long-term. And one of the challenges that I think faces us as a community is to ask the question, what are those short-term metrics that predict long-term? In healthcare, we always talk about validated surrogate endpoints. We need some valid surrogate endpoints so that we know in the short term we are on the right path. Also, I think the challenge, and I know in the group that works on the local systems within USAID, they are trying to grapple with this because they know that work is long-term development. And they talk about how do we look at process? How do we look at performance? I mean, I think the nursing story from Pakistan, it's such a wonderful story. And part of that story is that how would we have predicted the outcome when we started that project? I'm sure the project was all based on the nursing outcomes, and yet the true impact went far beyond that. So we need measurement tools that allow us to see those unpredicted outcomes. So I think evaluation is going to help us in terms of getting to that relevance piece. And the last part of this first section, I do want to come back to, I was reminded of the Governor General's comments. I went back in my notes, and indeed, he focused on innovation. In the U.S., innovation would have been every other word in this conference. So I appreciate that I didn't have to hear that all the time. But he did challenge us.
I have a very bad joke on this.
Okay. At any rate, he challenged us to identify innovative ways that higher education can support development. And he defined that as creative ideas of how to do it better. I know I heard about the micro research. I thought that was a very interesting example of using an innovative approach. It's not a technology fit. It's rethinking the model of how we fund projects. In this last panel that we heard on Rwanda and their rethinking the university, the three issues that were identified by Paul Davenport, academic freedom, institutional autonomy, participative decision-making, all things that we value in our higher education systems. Well, in the context of Rwanda, how do we become innovative in understanding what the principle is behind those goals, how we can live by those principles in a new and different context and be innovative in the way that we address it. And also in that context, create the experiment. I mean, in a sense, that's what you did. You created the experiment for them to live with some elements of those principles, and then from that learning, be able to move on from that point. So I think that's a wonderful model for us to think about when we're thinking about innovation. So I will.
Thank you. Now, Jean has to tell us the joke first.
No, not that one. I'll do another one. First of all, okay, you might think that I'm suffering, from acute attention deficit, because if you have looked at the monitor or me at the front, I'm always on my telephone tweeting things. Well, first of all, it's true, but it's because it keeps my concentration on what is being discussed. And I can punch a few words that I'm hearing and that makes sense. So, no, I've never been diagnosed with acute attention deficit. I never reached a place to do the test. I got distracted in between. So now, because you're a great audience, you're all going to wave at me, and I'll show my boss that I'm doing my job.
Very good.
Wave. More than this, yes. Clap, yeah. Good, perfect.
It will. You're proving that you're controlling the audience.
No, not at all. And the second thing I need to do before I get, and I'll be very brief, I have a top 10 list, is that I want to really dive into something that has brought to me a lot of traffic on my email and in the room over here. What is the oldest university in the world? Now, I didn't want to offend anyone. I never thought that I was going to open a Pandora box of this nature. And I got, people from Italy that says, yeah. I got people from Egypt that says, Jean. I got, even the chair of the Akagan Foundation Canada that, mention it in front of my minister. I've been monitoring my email throughout the day. But I just want to mention to you, and thanks to a colleague that I will not name because then she'll get, the fire of email, that according to a very reliable source, and this is not Wikipedia, no, I work at IDRC, I've been there for 20 years, I've consulted the Guinness Book of Records, and the oldest university is University Al-Karawiyyin in Morocco, in Fez, that was established in 859. So anyone that wants to debate on these things, you're welcome to consult a more reliable source. And I just brought it as a point to warm up the audience with the Governor General in the room. Now, Eva, my apologies to the panel. Top 10 list. I'm not reporting in any given order. I'm not reporting in the terms of what is the most important. I'm telling you things that I've heard that I knew before coming in, but things that I've heard also that caught me a bit by surprise and I think that are worth mentioning. no order particular, but I can tell you, if you would have asked me yesterday, as Khalil did at the dinner, private dinner, I would have mentioned access and relationship between education and employment. These are my two first. Then the tools. There has been an extensive conversation on tools that are used now, that are whether open education, that are distance learning, that are multi-form, and that we can put under a heading that I never heard before, probably because I'm not an expert in the field, blended learning. The quality versus the quantity, a predominant, you know, topic in the plenary as well and in breakout session. Something that surprised me very much. Universities as safe space for creativity, ID, debates to take place and not become, you know, driven by other factor than pure, you know, intellectual engagement in order to find the best solution from multiple perspective. Leadership. Brain drain, brain circulation, brain retention, you know, we should bring a neuroscientist the next time we meet, if we meet again. But I think that what I've heard there are the extreme of a continuum. And my personal perspective in this is that, you know, as Leonard so well said yesterday, you know, I need to make my living. And if you're a researcher in a developing country, you're part of a global market. You're not part of the developing country market. And who could blame someone to get a better, you know, life somewhere else, wherever it is? But what do we do to enhance the capacity in countries where there's a desire to promote higher education? What do we do in terms of support? And we have heard numbers of examples of things that are getting done, and I think that's something that, you know, was important to me. That's number six. Seven, I've learned from multiplicity of example. I'm a practical person, pragmatic person, and those examples are great. When you sum them up, you know, I don't think that we have as negative as sometimes picture that we think. There are extremely important things that I've heard that reach out to multiple, and I mean millions of people, and we'll dive into the question too on this. So being ambitious and bold, yes. Action-oriented. What I prefer in all these conversations were speakers that came and thank you to for all your contribution about what is this really changing? You know, what is the outcome that you're trying to achieve? And some of you have demonstrated, you know, vibrant outcome. And one thing that Rita Roy mentioned, but keep coming back in different way, long-term engagement. I'm not talking here about 5 years. I'm not talking about 10 years. I'm talking of a journey that IDRC embarked 46 years ago, that others have been there before. That links to the governance. That links to the institutional setting. You know, that links going beyond the fad. You know, higher education is like agriculture. You know, a lot of my roots are in agriculture. I can tell you, we cross a desert until the price spike in 2008, and it become again, whoa, we need to invest in agriculture. And what do we see now? A slow curve going down. So how do we maintain the momentum when we are not centerfold in the eyes of multiple stakeholders, be it government, private sector, philanthropy? You know, this is something that struck me. Last, partnerships. Partnerships, both on the substance, both on the finance, you know, in order to enhance research, to generate the knowledge and the innovation and the solution. But also, within this partnership, I've heard, you know, the dimension of maintaining the equation at the right equilibrium. This is not a northern-driven agenda. It is not a southern-driven agenda. This is a globally-driven agenda. And I think that there's sufficient brain power all over this room and around the world to work together to find, you know, diversity and originality and creativity, as the Governor General called on us yesterday, to find solutions that are long-lasting. So thanks.
Thank you very much for your top 10 and for being precise and action-oriented. Shams, please.
Thank you. I want to start out by reinforcing Lebel's point that universities are actually permanent institutions. Once you create a university, you seldom hear about a university dying, unless there was a definite move from the government or from the founders. Now, if they are permanent resources, they are not just resources for educating young people or creating knowledge, but they are also resources for development. And that's an important point we heard today. And I particularly want to mention that our experience has been absolutely along those lines. And our most recent experience at the University of Central Asia, we picked locations for our three campuses in the mountain areas of Kyrgyzstan, Kazakhstan, and Tajikistan, because there are marginalized communities in those locations. And what did we do? We trained people to become masons or carpenters or brought up small entrepreneurs to become small contractors, and we didn't build the campus with one big general contractor. We brought in a strong team of engineers and broke up the $100 million project into small contracts. And we insisted that local contractors who had learned skills that we had actually given them earlier, they were encouraged to do small things like building a road. Then the next year they came along and built some walls and so forth. And that has had a huge impact. Now, in a small, almost a economically dying town of Narin, which is in the mountains of Kyrgyzstan, people couldn't understand for a long time why we would want to do this. I'm giving you an example to the point where 60% of the folks working there are from that town or from that near district. And in the next campus in Korog in Tajikistan, 95% of the people on our campus building the university, there are 625 of them, 95% are from the local district. Now, that means that money that we are investing in the university, just for the building part, I'm not talking about the operations, that's the real impact. That money is going right into the economy. And so that's an important achievement. And it also means that once you have got the university built and you are the big frog in the small pond, that's bad. Universities must learn to live with their communities. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you get a town gown situation. And look at the number of situations in this part of the world or in Europe where there's been a town gown situation. So one of the early things that His Highness particularly advised us and spoke with the local government there and said, we would like to help you. What is it that you need? Oh, we got no health facility here, and we are also very keen on getting some school, early childhood development. He said, we will work with you. You provide this, we'll provide that, we'll make a team, and we will give you this support. With the result that very soon the folks in that little town began to imagine the reality of how Oxford, from a sleepy village 800 years ago, became known not for because it was a sleepy village, but because some university took root. And I cannot tell you how difficult it is now for us to explain to them that it won't happen tomorrow. No, but we are a university town. Now, look at the impact. And we are doing it in three places. And even I, who was very much involved with the early feasibility, I could not imagine the power of that. And we have not even started operating. Before we started our computer sciences program in Narin, We got an entrepreneur just last month who said to us, I saw your presentation, I'm so excited, I'm starting a startup program for software development right next to your campus. Because your graduates will be from here and I will employ them and I know they will take root here, they'll not run away. So that's one, impact, which is a permanent resource. The second thing, and I'm going to skip some of the points that our colleagues have made, quality is essential. Really, it is quality, quality, and quality. And should not be seduced, as one of my friends told me, should not be seduced by the attraction of large student numbers. Quality may be used as a higher leverage for impact rather than large numbers. This morning, my colleague Firoz Rasool spoke about that. But I can say that look at all the big universities and the major universities that have an impact. They are not looking at quality. I'm not saying that you should not have quality. That's not my point. But we should encourage centers of quality that make an impact because they have an impact of pulling. You know, it's like tiramisu. You've got to pull yourself to the sky. And you've got to have that magnet of pulling, which only a quality university will do. Give you an example. When we started the Aga Khan University, there were no private universities. This is 1983 when the charter was given. Between the Suez Canal and Japan, there were no private universities. American University in Cairo and AUB on this side of the Suez, and the Japanese universities. There was nothing in India, nothing in Bangladesh, nothing in Malaysia. And
I'm checking.
You made a Twitter.
check the age of Oxford.
I'll send you an email.
Okay. So the point was, once a private university, and the government of Pakistan took a very bold decision, they bet on His Highness's reputation of developing something good, and some of us were fortunate to do something about it. And as a result, there was a huge recognition that a private university can achieve something, and by gum, the government hasn't to pay anything, except maybe give some fiscal concessions. And the outcome is, we in Pakistan alone, we have now some 50 or 70 private universities. In India, there's three times as many. In Malaysia, everywhere you go, there are private universities. It is the power of that one example, and that is what a university is all about. Make one example that is powerful, whether it's the nursing school or it is creation of this permanent institution. Finally, I want to dwell on one last point, and which really is a lesson from yesterday. Leonard Wanchetkon's point was very powerfully illustrated by him, but I resonated with it so well because he said, we tend to underestimate the complexity of the socioeconomic development of a society. We assume that government will throw money at it and things will happen. We assume that the people will do what we tell them or will be persuaded to do because the politicians or the bureaucrats or the academics said something to them. But the reality is it's very complicated. And the complication is much more when you think about improving or reforming higher education, which, by the way, in the developing world, is in huge, huge need of reforms, which is a conference we can have on its own. I had the privilege of leading the reforms of higher education in Pakistan. And the biggest impediments were the vice chancellors. They just would not accept. And I went to 64 different gatherings with students and faculty members, all objecting. And once we got the reforms in, and the next government came and said, we want to change it, who opposed it? The vice chancellors. Because now they had got the freedom. They had been appointed not by the president or by the prime minister. They had a process. And so the complexity of bringing those reforms was huge. And we should not underestimate. It needs consistent and persistent effort. Just to conclude on a quote that His Highness made to us, or he said to us when we were chartering the university, he said, remember, you're building a new university. It takes decades to build a good school. A university may take much, much longer. So it is not instant coffee that you pour water and you start. That's not how universities are built. And in the 35 years that AKU has been in existence, it's a blink of an eyelid in the history of universities that our historian has dredged up here.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you for underlining once again the complexity and the need for not underestimating the time that it requires to build higher education institutions of quality. Our last commentator on what we have heard and what we have learned. Please, Jeffrey.
If I go back to what I saw as the original question, what are universities and university communities, what does it take for them to be able to contribute to sustainable development and meeting sustainable development goals? In general, the message that I took most strongly was that we must all start together with the problem and then look for the solution, having already thought about the problem. Recognizing that those problems, the most pressing development problems, are almost certainly complex ones, that therefore require a multi-dimensional solution, which in turn requires that we work on them as multi-sectoral, multidisciplinary teams, and that already has something, I think, to say about the way in which we organize academia and academics. Where I work, we often use the example of cleaning up a major waterway. It's simply not enough to assign that to a team of water engineers. This is an issue that requires, obviously, water engineers, but we need environmental scientists, public health experts, education experts, people working on industrial policy, urban planning, regional governance. These are complex issues with very complex solutions. I think the other message that came through very strongly right from the beginning of yesterday evening's session was that those problems need to be first identified and described at the local level. The communities who live those problems are the ones that best understand the nature of the problem. And the example we had yesterday, about the analyzing why a particularly fertile area had become significantly poorer over time, linking that to the infrastructure that was required for farmers to reach the market and their reliance on certain one set of skills as opposed to another set of skills is a great example that, in this case, you need anthropologists. So working locally to identify and describe the problem and then engage both local expertise but also global knowledge, global experience, analytic skills, the kinds of skills that come from the global community. And that's where I think the global and the local come together, where universities in the global north and universities in the global south can come together alongside the communities that are living these problems. And all of this, I thought it was a very strong message, that all of this implies a context where local knowledge is valued, where there's a sense of of giving back, a sense of exchange, working with respect, and working with trust. So that was the first message that I really took out. The other was, we heard from either one side or the other, or occasionally a number of speakers who compared them, was this tension, whether apparent or real, between the lofty traditional objectives of the university, the academy, and the much more utilitarian objectives that public bodies often visit on universities and tertiary institutions in general. And I think that tension is paralleled in the quality versus quantity, in academic freedom versus accountability, between purity and engagement. So I think those are all similar ways of talking really about the same problem. Our university is there to teach us, I shouldn't say to teach, where one learns to think, to question, to doubt, to challenge, to dream. Is that the fundamental responsibility of universities? Or is it to prepare young people for the world that awaits them, when they open the doors of academia with their diploma in their pocket, whether that is entering the labor market and the world of work, or becoming good citizens of the society in which they choose to live. I'm relatively optimistic, because I think if there's one institution that can reconcile that tension, it's the university. Yeah. We were reminded also of the meaning of universitas. This is an institution that purports, that claims to some kind of universality. So I think the very fact that universities combine so many disciplines, they combine a whole range of studies, doctoral and postdoctoral studies, undergraduate master's programs, obviously increasingly two-year programs, certificate programs. I think this is a wonderful opportunity for the kind of cross-fertilization that can allow us to try to achieve both those mandates. And in a very practical sense, in the places that I have worked in higher education, employers, clearly they want technical knowledge. But even more importantly than technical knowledge, they want a set of generic skills that I think go along with this notion of thinking, challenging, questioning. They want critical thinking. They want people who can solve problems. They want innovation. And they want teamwork. So there are a whole series of generic skills that I think universities are very apt at applying. And I think typically universities have the wherewithal to diversify, to stratify, and to some extent specialize, and I'll come back to that in answer to another question, so that they can both respond to those lofty ideals, but also provide answers to relatively short-term economic needs. Just a couple of quick points, things that I thought were talked less of, and I was slightly surprised. Primary and secondary education came up often in antagonism to higher education. The sense that there was a limited pie, that people who make public policy decisions have to face a trade-off when they fund one or another, and this was in some sense a competition. There were people clearly who said, where do teachers come from? They come from universities, and that's quite right. You know, I think universities need to take a great interest and make sure they have a lot to say about primary and secondary education. If 10% of the cohort do not graduate from high school, that is 10% of the cohort that universities have less to recruit from. And if, as we know, is typical, that is biased and skewed against certain populations, often young women, ethnic minorities, socioeconomically disadvantaged youth, then that's a problem because your next Einstein may well be in that 10%. So that's important that universities engage around primary and secondary education. And finally, while we talked about funding as higher education needs more of it, I was surprised that there wasn't more conversation about the nature of that funding. Block grants versus per student capita funding versus pro-equity top-ups from the World Bank perspective for us, where there are scarce resources, they rarely need to be put into pro-equity around populations, around topics like health, STEM, education, or a mix of these methodologies. Thank you.
Thank you very much for also bringing to the fore some of the tensions that we identified, because generally speaking, I think the conference was very consensual. We agreed on most things. We identified a core set of imperatives that were similar. But I think some of the tensions that you have brought out are still to be debated, and the right balance between some of the concepts like quality and quantity. We've skirted around them, but we have not really delved into how do we address them and where is the right balance. And I think that one of the things that for me as IAU we have argued is that we should not put them, quality and quantity, or accessibility and quality, as a dichotomy. They can, and we need to figure out, they need to coexist. If we are to build inclusiveness, they must coexist. So I think, thank you for bringing that out. I also do agree completely that higher education has a role to play in a holistic sense in education, educational economics, educational planning, psychology. All of those domains can address primary and secondary education. And in fact, to the extent that Education for All, the previous UN program, has succeeded in some respects, that puts a great pressure on higher education because there are more students in developing nations wanting access. So thank you very much. The second set of comments that I would like to invite our panel to consider, and I've given them the complete freedom and autonomy not to address them if they don't wish to, but the second set is really about what do we do, or what do we need to do, and with which partners do we need to work more in order to place higher education at the center of development policy and programs? How do we make this consensus be reflected in the policies of public policy on development? I think the question really was, can we start building a roadmap to see higher education more centrally placed in development policy? And that's a challenge. I think we all think this should be the case, but I think the competing priorities in public policy are standing in the way. So I would invite perhaps Jean, would you like to start with that?
So what is the question? Obstacle? As well as, you know, element and for a roadmap?
Yep. What stands in the way, and who do we work with to remove the obstacles?
Okay, these are tough questions. These papers are useless.
No.
Khalil, thanks for the support. Let me take a crack at it seriously. I think that, you know, this morning the minister asked us, you know, and I think she opened the door saying, you know, what would be the recommendation that you made, that you wouldn't make? I think I'm going to use what Leonard so brilliantly says number of times yesterday, you know, I don't know if it was in the public or in the dinner, but, you know, I count in three, and we all know that good bureaucrats count in three. You know, after three, the retention time tends to slip. So, you know, if I was to put three things forward, and they are not the right one, because everyone probably have three, and we can discuss how we can build a consensus. But I think that the issue of access, you know, is something that would come up to me as something that has been an obstacle for a long time, but is also an opportunity. And equal one, my own experience. I did my undergraduate, start my undergraduate in a university that was 12 years of age, Université du Québec à Montréal. I did also my PhD there. I went to McGill in between. I can tell you that from ICOM, and I don't need to drag on this, it would have been tough for me to get, you know, in the university system if there would not have been in Quebec at that time, and still is, a good public university system. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that relates, that's something that I feel in my bone, you know? And it was a new university with a public mandate. It was perceived as a place where you could only do strike and riot. I still see largely like this, but it's not like this. You know, it generate people that can become something in society, I think. But that's N equal one. Fellowship support, you know, grants to student, awards, is a mainstay of IDRC in terms to build leadership. And we can never respond to the demand. So, you know, I see this as something that you can throw on and on and on and on resources, and there will never be enough resources. So then we have to make hard choices. If we talk of higher education opportunity, what do we want to fund? I'm not sure. I don't know. But that's something I would question myself. We always think in institution, but the last panel, you know, with Paul Davenport and his colleague, pointed to governance and institution. I think institutional support is critical.
Absolutely.
University are there for, no, I cannot say this, 1,000 year, but, you know, they are, you know, for long term, you know, and how government support them in public institution, private sector, philanthropy, there's multiple model. But I'm a strong believer, because we are doing this currently, for example, in Kenya. Kenya created its first two chair, funded at the national level, one on agriculture, one on health. We partner with them. We say, well, you really want to do this? We're going to put $1 million. You're going to match it. In fact, it's them that says we're going to put $1 million, which was a total surprise. And they have their first two chair. I think that national government here or abroad need to put also resources in institution. And the granting facility in the Global South are now becoming more and more active. COSTECH in Tanzania provides support to engineer, you know, at the master and PhD level. They are part now of a program that we have with DFID, the British, and the National Research Foundation of South Africa to enhance capacity, strategize these research councils to match the need of their country with the effort that they make in support. Well, you know, the Director General told me last fall, Jean, just because we're part of this exercise that is relatively modest, $15 million, he has been able to quadruple his budget for grant to master student from $500,000 to $2 million in Tanzania. For me, that's a net gain. And I think that we need more of this. And there are opportunities in terms of access that, you know, we need to grasp because they are terrible. Refugees, 60 million around the world. Just take Lebanon, 40% of population that are composed of refugee almost. You know, 500,000 kids that are between 0 and 18, okay, that are in age to be at school. Well, the school system cannot cope with this. The curriculum has been split in two, morning for, you know, Lebanese kid, afternoon for half of the Syrian refugees that can fit within the school system. What do we do with the other half? 250,000 kids. keep growing month after month, they are not there for 1 month, 1 year. You know, before we get resolution of the Syrian conflict, these kids need to be educated. So increase the access with my second point, you know, new technology, innovation, new thinking, MOOCs, great. You know, at the university level, someone said this morning, and I think it was Patricia, but MOOCs made in the region, at the national level, in the right language, with the right content that match the need, I think that's critical. That will favor access, that will help to build, you know, the capacity for fixing all kind of problems. The last point I would say in terms of obstacle, you know, if I, this is a good formula, you know, rather than say, you know, the oldest university, you know, you say, I have been told, so then, you know, it's not you speaking, but that for every dollar that you invest in education, the return is from $10 to $15 in economic growth. But there's a challenge and an obstacle, I think, is about the poor performance and the engagement. You know, how do we secure the quality and the access? And I think here, again, there's a world of opportunity. Personalized learning is something that was discussed. The tool, great, but the tool are insufficient. It's what you do with them. They are only tool. We have an example, and I read my notes over here because it's a network that is long, and these people that work in network, can you make two words network? Research on open educational resources for development network. 26 countries that we are sponsoring through comparative research. You know, they are looking at increasing the educational policy and the practices. Well, an impact of this in Karnataka, India, 15,000 teachers have been trained in the use, in the performance, in the monitoring, in the evaluation of distance learning tools for their kids in school at various level. But they have been teach, and that's my last point, teacher, here or abroad. At the university, there's an aura. At lower level, there's a challenge. You know, my father was a high school teacher, and you know, the only thing I've heard throughout my life is that he had 8 weeks of holidays during the summer. I think that teachers, you know, is one of the most fundamental jobs in the world. And they need respect, they need support, they need to be, you know, just say to a teacher at school where your kid goes, you're doing a fine job. It's not perfect. You know, it makes a huge difference. Yes. And I think it's not only here, it's also abroad. Can we put the teacher back into the system with the student and provide our support to them? Whether it's through research for education tool, pedagogical tool, I pronounce it well, it's important. So these are my 3 points. Access, technological development, and securing the monitoring of the performance and the engagement.
And the policymakers will hear that that is what we need and will...
Well, the policymaker will listen to something if we come together, Eva.
Yes.
Thank you.
I think that what we have heard today, you know, is such a diverse group of people with such fantastic, you know, brain power and creativity that we have to make an effort. You know, your next question will be what we do next. I don't know what we do next. You know, we have this meeting. There's plenty of other meetings. You know, RU Forum, Ames, you know, Thierry is here. There's plenty of meetings where these issues are discussed. And that's okay with me. But I think it's for the audience to establish what will be the next step in order to provide a roadmap. And, you know, I'm looking at Khalil. We might want to think about this. But, you know, if you have any bright idea, you know, at idrc.ca, at Aga Khan Foundation Canada.ca or something, I think there will be a place to put your thoughts.
Thank you very much. Gentlemen, would you like to try?
Sure. I mean, I just wanted to really home in on one kind of obstacle, and I alluded to it in the first answer, talking about the need for you know, segmentation, specialization, stratification. I think that the World Bank's only, in a sense, has formally one kind of client, and that is a sovereign government. So we typically abord come to issues around higher education through the ministry, either the Ministry of Higher Education or a Ministry of Education in general. They are often very jealous of their national prerogatives. It's also our own, the way in which we do business has often exacerbated that problem in the sense that we have until recently almost overwhelmingly made loans or credits or grants to individual governments. We're moving more and more to regionally based operations, and we have one actually around African centers of excellence with eight countries in West and Central Africa, and really bringing together both the ministers of higher education, key public universities, who are also jealous of their, in a sense, universality, and working with them to show that there are possibilities for, let's say, through a centers of excellence approach, where each center takes on a regional mandate to achieve some economies of scale, to raise quality, to achieve greater efficiency, but in return, each government and each university recognizes that it's not going to be the best at everything, but promises when it wins an award for a center of excellence to serve a regionally based student population, create a network of regional faculty to engage the private sector in a regional way. And so I think, at least in some settings, the ability to look beyond one's own institution and look to partnerships, even if it's at a regional level, can be an important way of getting over some of the obstacles that come from lack of resources and lack of economies of scale.
Okay, thank you. I have a sign here that is telling me that we should move to a Q&A, which means that you're all off the hook with regard to the third question. But I will pose it so that the audience can perhaps jump in and help us answer that third question, which is really what can we do to maintain the momentum and the dialogue that has taken place here? What can we do to... what fora can we use to continue this discussion, and how do we take what we have all learned and what we are taking away, how can we take that and turn it into potentially some recommendations, in your case to the minister, in my case perhaps to UNESCO or to the World Bank. So I will open the floor, perhaps Ian. Oh, just one second. I have one request from a panelist, so please.
I wanted to be able to add to the discussion here with just, I'll keep it very brief.
And then I'll go to.
Because amongst the main obstacles, we've talked about resources. I think we all know that resources are limited. And I do think one of the responsibilities of donor governments is to think more flexibly about how they partner and how they look at their funding mechanisms. And I know in our experience in the U.S. that particularly in those countries where we have a large higher education investment, where we can leverage that to get those governments to think about their investment, yes, in higher education and their investment. And we're making progress. It becomes part of the dialogue. And I did want to highlight some places where I see some success that I think we can learn from. And the program that I'll highlight is Feed the Future in the U.S. And the reasons, some of the things that strike me as valuable in that program, it is a whole-of-government approach. Mm. USAID has a lead role, but we're tapping into all of our government agencies. So we're working together across agriculture, just any number of groups. And it's a whole of food approach, that it's not just what we put in the soil. We have nutrition as a part of it. We want nutrition-sensitive agriculture. So it's looking at the whole system, market to what comes out of the ground. And the third thing that I think is so important in that program is that it recognizes the need for both human and institutional capacity building, that we can invest in humans and make sure that we have equitable access as a part of that. But if they don't have institutions that they can come back to, then we're not necessarily getting to the long-term solution. So I just wanted to highlight those key points.
Perfect. May I turn to our audience? Okay. Ian McAllister, and then you.
Thank you very much. One of the challenges I think we have in the Canadian context, whether we're looking in our own regions or internationally, is to ensure we have in the discussion process the provincial governments. Internationally, it's the provincial governments that are frequently much more connected with the critical fields that are important to the international links, health, education, and so on. And I think we also are missing out if we don't somehow connect the provincial governments more into our entire foreign aid process, because not only do they have considerable amount to give, I think there's a huge learning process which comes out of it, and I think it would be a way of strengthening some of the visions of the provincial governments if we did this. So what I'd like to recommend with that as a part of it is that Canada establish a Royal Commission on Higher Education. Not some, you know, royal commissions are often put together in order to duck a question. I'm not suggesting that. I think that some real thoughtful analysis and a continuity of the things we've been hearing while we've been here today and yesterday. If I had a person to recommend to chair the Royal Commission from Canada, what's the Governor General going to be doing next? I'll leave it at that.
All right. Thank you.
We have the 2017 celebration after that.
Thank you for the wonderful opportunity to have this conference. I'm going to take your third question and add to that the continuity of gender mainstreaming inside of that dialogue. And what I'm going to add to that is from a global-driven agenda, and some of the places that that I think I'm thinking about and looking at are in inclusion of the South, the emerging markets, refugees, and the perspectives and the culture norms inside of those, when we look at issues and challenges that are, you know, at the grassroots level sometimes, you're looking at human trafficking, you're looking at early child marriage, you're looking at child labor happening in those areas. So when we look at closing the gender gap and the impact of closing the gender gap and that it has towards the holistic well-being and the health of the nation, institutions, and to the panel, how do you see the mandates of gender mainstreaming? How do you incorporate that gender mainstreaming into institutions, into, you know, private, public sectors at different levels?
Thank you for your question. Comments? Responses?
Well, maybe I can take one portion of that. Mm-hmm. It's a very, very, very important point because, and I'm talking on behalf of the countries of the South, because that's where I have more understanding. this has become a very important part of education. And if you look at university students in most countries of the South, including many Muslim countries, the number of female students is higher than male. At the Aga Khan University, when we started the university, we picked two professions, two areas of study, which I didn't pick, but I think it was His Highness's idea, that we will teach nursing and we will teach teacher education. In Pakistan or India or Bangladesh or South Asia or any part of Central Asia, a large number of teachers are women. And willy-nilly, we are educating them in one of the best places to be educated in that part of the world. And the result is that at the Aga Khan University, we have about 70% of the students who are female. 60% of the faculty members are female. And so, not by chance, but by design of picking out those areas of specialties which bring women professionals into the forefront, we were able to do this. And even if you take that away, if I look at the public universities in Pakistan or India, there is a very large number of women. And the problem is that women are excelling in getting into the university. That's not a problem, actually. That's a great advantage. So I think there is something happening there that we need to study much more in detail, and I'm glad you brought up the point.
Look, I think that, you know, on the gender side, you know, when I was bringing the access, you know, you were asking about the roadmap, you know, and the beauty with access is that you can make, you know, numbers of things fit under access. And, you know, I had girls and women on my sheet. But how do we do this? You know, I think that having access of women into higher education as professor is quite important, is one thing. But it's carrying the research also in understanding what prevent women to access higher education or what prevent women of going to school. You know, we had the Nasser Farouki, one of our staff here, manager, that have been working on, you know, sanitation and simple access to toilet for girls, you know, is a limiting factor in accessing education. How do we fix this? You know, through, you know, collaborative work across different domains. But I think access is something that is bringing under its umbrella numbers of things that I think a minister would listen to.
I completely agree, and the minister spoke about gender and access for girls.
Can I just add a comment that I think the issue that you raise is one of the reasons why USAID decided it needed a tool for assessment of gender, so that in a project, it's not bringing our assumptions about what are the issues that might create barriers or limit access, that the assessment is designed to look at the system in place so we understand it from that perspective. And in the design of the program, then, we're using that information. It's not that we're going to change everything overnight, but we do have to start where systems are and make the right progress from that point.
Thank you. Please.
Yes. Hi. I just came back from a project in Suriname working with a polytechnical college to develop a strategic plan to advance them into a new level. And, you know, what it really occurred to me there, as I saw there, was that the technical education side of things is very much a poor cousin, even to the universities, which may not be, you know, funded in an exemplary way either. And as much as we've talked about a brain drain here, there's a skills drain in many of these countries also. I don't know how common this problem is in other countries. So I just wonder where, in the institutions that you represent, where post-secondary technical education comes into the puzzle and into your funding models. Are you as interested in that, in finding the next, not just the next Einstein, but the next Mike Holmes? Mm-hmm. You know, is that part of your plan?
Very good.
Thank you for your question. Would you like to start? Because you already touched it.
Maybe I can start a bit and others can follow. You're making a very important point, because universities are traditionally seen as places where you only award degrees, which is a very important part. But in our experience at the University of Central Asia, we didn't start with the degree programs. We said if we started with the degree programs, it will take 4 or 5 years for the students to get a bachelor's degree. Then they will go for a master's. Some of them will go even higher. And it'll be a good maybe 7 to 10 years before the impact of that education is making on that society. So what we started was with vocational training and the tools of earning a livelihood in a post-Soviet Union situation. For example, anybody who knew anything about English or could read and properly compose a tertiary level of literacy, they got a job like that from any of the embassies that were now coming in, from aid agency offices, from the UN. They were in demand. They were being paid money like they never saw before. That was an impact that the university made. We taught them how to do financial accounting. Post-Soviet Union system didn't have this kind of training. So, absolutely right. I just want to confirm to you that universities do have that responsibility of going through different levels. And don't let's... One of the reasons why TVET programs, technical programs, are not being respected by parents or by society at large is because they are not in universities and they are not in institutions or colleges. They're in some relegated place where you just learn as a craftsman. And that's one of the things we can make a contribution.
Let me just schedule the rest. We have two comments here. And then I have two last questions. And you will be the last question, okay, so that everyone knows. Thank you. Please.
Okay. Yes, workforce development is one of the priorities in our education strategy, and we have a community of practice built around that. Just to keep it brief, that one of the ways we have worked on that strategy is developing partnerships between community colleges in the United States and institutions in developing countries. And that model of community college, where you have the vocational training, the skills development, but you also have a route back into a four-year college, it's not a very common model outside of North America. And so part of our goal often is to open some dialogue, but it's a prestige issue, but it is something that's very much a part of our strategies. We see that as critical, both as a youth development issue as well as a labor force issue.
Thank you.
No, very similarly, I've already spoken about diversity and diversification. We encourage universities to diversify in ways that are responsive to their socioeconomic environment. An example, I worked a lot in Tunisia, and many universities now offer shorter-term programs, legal departments that offer paralegal programs and paralegal. You get paramedical, technician training in engineering departments. And I think one of the advantages of having universities do this is that there is the opportunities for more seamless paths through academia, so that in fact you can complete a two-year program and either go into the workforce or go into a longer-term program, or go out into the workforce and come back and complete a longer program at a later date.
Thank you very much. I'm living under the tyranny of this screen here. So I'm going to ask the two questions to be asked at the same time, and we'll answer both at the same time. Thank you.
Thank you so much for the presentation. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So we spoke a lot about universities, the role of universities in delivering quality education, but as we all know that learning and education happens every day, everywhere, in different contexts, and I was wondering if you could just comment on how you can take advantage of these informal avenues of learning in an international development context? Thank you.
Very good question. And please.
Thank you. So I'll try to just make a comment and not ask a question. I just wanted to talk about the inclusiveness that you talked about earlier and what Mr. Lebel was saying about refugees. And it's just to wrap up in what the sir just said about the vets. I wanted to say that for refugees, it's very important, given the powerless context in which they live, so refugees in camps, that they, the inclusiveness that we're talking about is asking them what do they want to learn based on what they already know how to do or what they've learned before, and not just come with a one-size-fits-all program for every different crisis when it's different contexts. Something very important that Mr. Lebel said is that refugees will have they will stay really long periods of time, but they don't know how long. Sometimes, I think the average is 17 years of displacements, and sometimes you have three generations in one camp while they're telling you, oh no, I'm going back to my country tomorrow or next year, so I don't need to go to school because I won't finish, I'm going back. But you don't know when you're going back. And the last point I want to make is about, someone talked about the cultural aspect, I think it was this morning. I think it's very important, and it comes back to inclusiveness, is that refugees sometimes will have parallel schools because they don't want to lose their culture or their language, so they won't have their kids going to any UN or any other humanitarian actor school because they want to keep their own culture and language, and we need to think about that when we come up with solutions for them. Thank you.
Thank you very much for very important nuances to consider when we work in crisis situations and refugees. Would you like to comment about informal, non-classroom learning? That was the last question, how we can contribute from that to international development. Anyone?
No, I mean, really only to say that clearly important that universities engage in frameworks, a recognition of prior learning that fit into larger frameworks of recognizing learning by degrees, by skill levels, and one of the things that we're trying to work on in terms of engaging the private sector is having the private sector help define what the learning outcomes should be. And I think often the private sector and private sector employers have a very good understanding of what young people and older people, for that matter, in lifelong learning situations have acquired in informal, semi-formal, job-based learning. So a combination, I think, of that's one area where I think private-public partnerships can be very important.
Thank you. Anyone else? Jean and then.
Just a couple of quick comments. I mentioned in the earlier panel the priority around public service and community engagement for higher education institutions, and I think informal education is a key part of that. It's learning from the community, but it's also taking the knowledge that's generated within the university and applying it in community settings that where the information can be most relevant. I mean, in the U.S., our cooperative extension model is probably the example I would give, where we've just had a history of universities being relevant to every person in the state because that county extension program exists in the county. It's part of the university, but it's also a part of their local context. So it's an important, I think it's something that's critical for higher education to do.
Eva, as it written, wrap up panelists, stay in seats, you know. I'll just say that, you know, the access in the roadmap, technological change, you know, I'm not sure. Maybe it's innovation. Maybe it's, you know, how do we support, you know, new tools, new ways of teaching? How do we support new institutional setting, new financing, you know, new articulation of partnership? And the last point about, you know, the engagement and the performance measurement is all about the quality.
you know, and the quality and the quantity. So I don't know if they are the right words. I don't know if they are the right element. And because of that, I will not be prescriptive, but I have my colleague, Tavinder Nijawan, over here that is saying, oh no, Jean, don't do this to me. She has been the IDRC lead on this conference with the Aga Khan team of Khalil. And Tavinder, can we secure that for a few weeks, you know, we send a message to all the participants, and we put something with our social media, you know, geek, where people can send, you know, their ID. Be brief, be very short. Now, I don't commit to anything, but at least we will get from you a repository of perspective on what should be the three elements of a roadmap. And I'm not promising that we will synthesize this and make a brilliant document, but at least we will know what are your thoughts if you want to contribute. And that, I think, something. Khalil, I don't know if you would be okay with to do this. He's okay, so he will be providing the funding. And I'm teasing you. Thank you very much,
everyone. Thank you so much. Let me do exactly what this screen is. This is the wrong side of technology, having that in front of you. Let me thank the panelists for really engaging in a conversation, which is not all easy to do. I was going to suggest that one of the important sequels to this conference, it's not a roadmap and it's not the next step, but I think it is really very important to find a place where we can see the very, very good presentations of case studies that we heard. There was a wonderful presentation on what York University and UBC are doing in Kenya in the refugee camps there. And it's just a learning opportunity. So that goes right along with what Jean has just said. I would like to thank our panelists very much for their insightful and good, solid contributions to this discussion, and I'd like to thank all of you and invite you to join me in thanking them again.
Thank you.
Thank you
to you.
Thanks.
Thank you, Eva.
I didn't change the questions.
Thank you very much to the panel. And Jean and Eva, I think you've left us with fantastic, tangible next steps to move forward as we wrap up our last day of the conference, so thank you for that. We are at the end of the conference, but before you leave, we would greatly appreciate if you could just take the next minute or two to fill out the printed surveys that are currently on your table. They really help us better understand what you took away from the conference and how to improve future events. If you're missing a copy, just flag your hand and someone will bring one around. So we'll just do that for the next minute or so. Thank you.
No, yes, they're evaluating you. Keep on jotting, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to just say a few words by way of conclusion, and just to announce at the very beginning, I'm not going to be a slave to this screen. Friends, ladies and gentlemen, it's with a great deal of humility and delight that we now bring our proceedings to a close. The burden of trying to summarize the content of our deliberations has been substantially relieved by the extraordinary performance of this panel, who have, I think, with pith and with wisdom, drawn out many important lessons for us. I can tell you that I, at least, am an avalanche of ideas as a result of the conversations we've had here, and more than that, to the agony of the team at AKFC, an avalanche of ideas about what we should do next, at least from AKFC's perspective. I mean, it's been very, very provocative, and I can tell you that I can see a very clear institutional agenda, at least for AKFC, coming out of this. So I want to thank you all for inspiring that. it's really left to me now to express gratitude to a number of people who have made this possible. First of all, of course, all of you. We have been very heartened and encouraged by the interest that has been expressed by people from across the country and around the world in engaging on this issue and this topic. It has vindicated, I think, the organizers' own set of convictions that this is a timely and important issue. I want to, of course, express on behalf of all of us our gratitude to His Excellency the Governor General for setting the table last night with such eloquence and throwing down such important challenges to us. It really was an inspiring way to start. And, of course, Madame Bibeau this morning, who also endorsed the directions I think we were discussing. All of our speakers and moderators have been superb. And, of course, the heart of any conversation like this really rests on the quality of people who are presenting ideas. And I'm very, very grateful to all of the people who took time out of all their busy schedules to participate. I mean, knowing something about the speakers from our own system, Feroz, Shams, and knowing the demands on their time up close, and I suspect it's the case with all of our speakers, I know what a sacrifice it is for them to travel to be here, and I really am grateful for that. Tracy Evans has kept us on track all day today, for which we're grateful. The Government of Canada has been a very, very generous financial supporter of this effort. Our sponsors for the conference, my co-sponsors, IDRC and Academics Without Borders, without which this would not have been possible. There was a conference executive committee very ably and deftly chaired by Greg Moran. Greg, stand up. Can all the conference executive committee stand up? Stephen Brown, Tavinder, if you're still here, Corey, Jennifer, Carrie, Shabana, Maria, I think, may have left. Thank you all for all your efforts in steering this conference forward. There were a number of volunteers behind the scenes here. We've got an extraordinary gift at the delegation of the Ismaili Imamat of a number of young people who are guides, tour guides, ushers, who keep the machinery of this place running when we host here. And for that, we are very, very grateful. An army of people behind the scenes that all of our AV folks, all the people who are serving throughout, we're very grateful for all of that. I have to say there's an AKFC team that has put in an enormous amount of effort. Jennifer, Carrie, Shabana, a lot of other people who have been involved in putting this on. They do AKFC proud, and I'm very proud of them today. And of course, all of you who have been working on these issues here and in the developing world, who are laboring under some very exceptionally difficult circumstances. I want to express our gratitude for the work you do. When you walk into Shams's office in Kyrgyzstan, there is a big monitor that counts down the number of days to when the first undergraduate students will walk in the doors in Naryn at their new campus. And he does that because he wants everyone at the university to know that we are on a timetable. And it's not just for the University of Central Asia. I mean, one of the great tensions of this work and of this conversation is that while on the one hand we have generational time horizons, maybe of a millennium set of time horizons, we are also at a time in the history of the world when the fragilities we are encountering and the forces at work are frankly so severe that there is also great urgency. There is a countdown clock. We cannot live in repose. The work that we are talking about, as long-term as it is also terribly, terribly urgent. We do not have time to wait. We must act, and we must continue very thoughtful, intelligent, smart investments, and we must do them now. We have certain windows open to us, and I'm very grateful for all of you who have helped to inform what might be the action plans for many, many institutions going forward. I can tell you, at least for the foundation in Canada, this is going to be a major, major priority for us in the coming days and months and years. So thank you. It's with whatever power is invested in me by me, I now very happily declare the conference adjourned. Thank you.